In our lecture on numerical methods, we discussed the Monte Carlo method. So we had some convergence results. And we talked about Monte Carlo integration before. So Monte Carlo integration here is that we can approximate the integral from say 0 to 1 f of x dx by say a sum over some sample points. So xi uniform drawing. So that motivated the question how to generate xi. Okay, the first thing I like to discuss is the so-called pseudo-random number generators. We will later see another way of generating, say, a sequence of numbers, the quasi-random numbers. But I believe that will be a separate session. So what does here pseudo random number generation mean? So actually the word pseudo random refers to the fact that actually the prediction of the sequence is very hard. Yeah? Of course, in the computer, there's an algorithm behind this. And if you know the algorithm and if you know the number, you know the next number because it's just generated by this algorithm. So it's actually not random, but the sequence has actually appears random and has properties or shares properties with a sequence of true uniform distributed random numbers. For example, the expectation corresponds to the expectation we expect from the distribution, yeah, so 1/2. The variance corresponds to the variance of the distribution, and so on. So the term very hard, yeah, is not very precise, yeah, but there are different algorithms in the literature which say are harder to predict than others. Let's start with the first example. So the first example is a linear congruential random number generator. Okay, so maybe you've seen this before. A linear congruential generator is actually defined by four integers. Okay, so the four integers are the initial value. So this is given, the initial value. The initial value of my sequence. And then I have a rule how I generate the next number. The rule is multiply the initial value, so you multiply the initial value with some constant A, and then add to the result some constant C, and then take the modulus of this and M, yeah, take the modulus with respect to M, which gives you then the next number. So the sequence is actually defined by these four numbers, a multiplication, addition, and then the modulus. And if you recall our session on integers, then having a modulus is like having here the line of numbers 0, 1. Okay, and then it continues like a circle. Okay, and then the last number here is m minus 1. Okay, and whenever you perform an arithmetic operation, you go along the line, yeah, and this is a little bit, if you cross the m minus 1, you will jump back to 0. So actually what this random number generator is doing is a little bit like a wheel of fortune. So this is like a wheel of fortune. Yeah, because the number a is quite large, yeah, So maybe we turn the wheel, we turn around many times by multiplying this number, then the number C is also maybe a bit larger. Yeah, so we could maybe jump across this modulus by this addition, and then we take the modulus. Okay. So actually the Java random number generator, Java util random, is exactly of this kind. And you can have a look at this. So maybe you can have a look at such random numbers. So here was our session on some experiments, yeah. So with streams, and maybe I add another one here below. Okay, let's have some loop for I from 0 to say 100. Okay, and then have some random number. We can call math.random if you like, yeah, and let's print this number. Okay, so if you run this, he will print the sequence. Okay, and actually the sequence looks quite random, yeah, 0.4, 0.5, 0.7, yeah, and a lot of digits. And this sequence was actually generated by this random number generator. Okay, so a remark. This one generates an integer between 0 and m minus 1, yeah, because we are using the modulus. Yeah. Then we convert to a floating point double, so we convert this to double on the interval 0 and 1, 0 included, 1 not included, by saying that let's call the double z. Okay, so let's call the double z I. So then z I is just x I divided by m. Yeah. So if you look here in the implementation of math.random, you see that actually this creates a floating point number greater than or equal to 0 and less than 1. Yeah, so 1 is not included. Yeah, so actually they are just doing this. Then maybe another remark. Since this is modulus m, the generator can only generate m different numbers. Yeah, so between 0 and m minus 1 for the integers, or the xi divided by m. These are only m different numbers. And once you hit a number again, the sequence will repeat, yeah, because the sequence, the next value, just depends on the previous value. Okay, so the previous value determines the next value. So if you have just m different numbers, and if the next number just depends on the previous number, the full sequence will repeat once you hit a number again, and that will happen after m numbers for sure. Yeah? So the period length, so the moment when the sequence will repeat of this generator is at most m. That means we would like to have this number m quite large. Okay, so we would like to have it quite large. Okay, so for example, here for the Java util random number generator, Java util random. This one is a linear concurrential generator, and the M is 2 to the power of 48. So the period length is at best something like 10 to the power of 14. These generators have some bad properties, some undesired properties. So they are quite okay for simple experiments, but they are better one. So one of these properties is that you actually can prove that if you generate a higher dimensional random vector from such a sequence, you remember, we know how to do this. The jth component of the ith random vector point is just xi times d, d is the dimension, plus j in our sequence. So we populate one after the other component to generate a new vector, and then we jump to the next vector. Okay, if you have this method to generate a multidimensional vector and you use a linear concurrential generator, then you can actually prove that the points which you generate, they lie on at most m to the power of 1 divided by d different hyperplanes. So for example, here with our Java util random, if we use 84 dimensions, and 84 dimensions could happen, yeah, so then this somehow gives us that the random vectors lie on at most 2 hyperplanes. Yeah, and being on a hyperplane actually means that out of the 48 components, there is one dependent component, and 47 independent ones. Yeah, so it's only independent in 47 dimensions. Okay, so maybe sometimes this doesn't hit you because also your function which you are evaluating has to be that way that it has a certain dependency in a direction which is actually not independent. This is maybe now a criteria to judge the quality of this random number generator. Okay, so I would like to just mention another one. Yeah, so this is just maybe a collection. A random number generator which is very possible is the Mersenne twister. Yeah, I also have a reference to a literature here. And the Mersenne twister, it has a period length of 2 to the power of 90,937 minus 1. That is to say, the sequence repeats after 2 to the power of 90,937 sample points. So it has a very long period length. And actually in this paper I attached here, you can see that this one is also equidistributed in high dimensions. So you have equidistribution up to 623 dimensions, so which is maybe already what is sufficient in most of our applications. Let's see. Okay. So that one is very popular, and we can also use it. There is an implementation provided in the library. Okay. So I would like to go back here to this point of generating, say, a vector from a sequence. Yeah. So I prepared some code. I could also just maybe do the code with you together, but maybe just read the code here. So where do I have this code? I have here the code of a random vector. Okay. So you see it's very short. So I'm using the Java util random generator. So you know that this is a linear concurrential generator. Okay. Then you see there's an argument here. Yeah. So there's an argument here, this number, and this number is actually the seed, the initial value of the random number generator. So maybe you use some number to initialize this random number generator. If you provide this seed to the class, it will generate always the same sequence, because if you go back to the definition of our random number generator, this seed is here the initial value. So the initial value is, the seed of the random number generator. And if you use the same seed, it will always generate the same sequence. So maybe you believe it is an advantage to do not have the same seed for every run. So you get a different value in every run. Yeah, you can do this. Here, for example, if you do not provide a seed, he will generate a different sequence whenever you call it again. So actually, if you look into the implementation, what he does is he uses a seed. Yeah? I mean, it's a computer. He has to do something, but the seed which he is using is just the time, okay, in milliseconds or in nanoseconds. Yeah? So calling it again uses a different time as the seed. Yeah, and from the computer clock, and so it has a different sequence. In many of our experiments, it's actually good to use the same seed for the sequence, because if you like to debug your code and getting different result whenever you run it, it's maybe a problem. For example, consider the case where your code has some error, and this error, say, has a small bias in your result. Now our Monte Carlo sequence generates different numbers whenever we have a new sequence. Yeah? So it could happen by chance, yeah, that the error is compensated. So actually it's good to compare with different seeds, yeah, to see where your result is, yeah, to see the variance. But if you use a different seed in every iteration, it's often hard to debug. Okay, so then I would like to create a random vector. So that is to say, here I have yij. Yeah. So yij. So it is a double array indexed by I and j. Yeah. So actually, where the first index is the length of the sequence of random number, and the second, the j, is the component. Yeah. So the length of the second array field here is the dimension. Okay. And then, so create here a 1D random number generator, and that is our memory for the D dimensional sequence Yeah, so it's indexed by sample index and component index. Okay, so then I have a constructor, so you can specify the length of this sequence and you can specify the dimension, and we populate it by going inside over the dimension, just take the next random number, and we go outside over the length of the sequence. Okay, so this is populate the vector. So y, let's write some LaTeX here. Yxj is x sub I times d plus j. And x is the sequence of random numbers. So this is here the sequence xk. Okay, and then I have some method. So if I would like to have the full sequence, I just return it. If I would like just the a point, yeah, for a given sample index, I just return a vector which has the values for every component. And if I would like to have a component, I just access the component. If I would like to have a sequence horizontally cut through my vector, so I would like to have a sequence of one-dimensional random numbers for a given components, actually then I have to cut through my vector. So I allocate a new vector which has the length of the sequence. So this is now yi for a fixed j. The fixed j is this value. And then I copy this yi for a fixed j to this vector. Yeah? Okay. So actually there's a small implementational detail here. Yeah. You see that since we have chosen the layout of our memory in this way, so first sample index, then component index, this makes it easy to return a vector for of components for a fixed sample index, but it makes it complicated to return a sequence for fixed component index. Okay, so it's easy to return a vector of components for fixed sample index, but it's complicated to return a sequence of samples for fixed component index. But this is just because we used this way here. Yeah. Alternatively, if you would use the other way around, like that, so first component index, then sample index, this would just switch here the way we use the indices here. So it wouldn't be difficult to change this. Okay, and we also had to switch this here, the size. But it would make actually this method here more complicated, and it would make this method more easy. So and here you see a nice example of encapsulation. The way we organize our memory is private, so it's our decision. And actually, you can change this depending on your application. Is it actually more often that you need a sequence for a fixed component? Or is it more often that you need a vector of components for a fixed sample? And you have to make this decision because it makes your code faster or slower. Okay, so that was a small code session on how we generate this vector. Actually, I just wanted to show you this because I have created a plot from this. So I have a plot using now our random vector in, say, two dimension with 1,000 points. And let's run the plot. And it looks like this. Okay, so let's finish the lecture. So if we use this point, we get a random vector in two dimensions with 1,000 points. And you clearly see the randomness. There is less structure. Okay, there's not much structure. But actually one thing is a little bit, raising some concern, yeah, because there are some areas where we do not find any points. Okay, sometimes these areas are quite large. So what if our function, which we are integrating, actually has a lot of variability in this area? Then we miss some area. On the other hand, there are a few areas where we have many points. So for example, here, there are three points very close together. Or here, we have also some cluster. Yeah? But is it really that our function is so important in this area? Okay, so the randomness is a feature, but this is a bit strange. And let me go back to the Monte Carlo integration, because I like to show you one last thing, which then motivates the next session. We had actually this little Monte Carlo integrator here. We were using Mersenne Twister with a number of points. And then we integrated our integrand. And our Monte Carlo integration test was to integrate the cosine, and we compared it to the true solution. So that was done in the last session. So if we run this test, actually we get this result, minus 1.017. The true solution is minus 1.800. If we use fewer points, yeah, we get less accurate. Okay, so that was our Monte Carlo convergence. Let me modify this code a little bit. And maybe this looks stupid in the beginning. I create another integrator here just by copying this one, and I call this say quasi Monte Carlo integrator. Oh, it already exists, so let's delete this here. That, so let's create here by copying a new class calling quasi Monte Carlo integrator. Okay, so this is now called quasi Monte Carlo integrator. And now I just modify the way I generate the random numbers. So let's remove this and generate a stream of random numbers. Oops. Differently, by I generate a stream of integers. Namely from 0 to number of evaluation points. That's, we need so many points. And then I use the map to double. The map to double with the following function. The integer I is mapped to, so this should be a sequence of random numbers. So it's just mapped to I times 1 divided by number of evaluation points. Yeah, so if we have 4 evaluation points, the first one is 0, the next one is 1 over 4, 2 over 4, 3 over 4, 1 is not included. This is just an equidistributed discretization of the line. So these numbers are not random at all, but if you consider this problem, these numbers fill the space evenly. Okay, actually, what happens if we do this? What happens if we do this? So let's... Okay, I have to delete this here. So what happens if we do this? Let's copy the Monte Carlo integrator test here. Call it quasi Monte Carlo integrator test. So I have a new test here and I just modify one line, namely here, the integrator which we use is now the quasi Monte Carlo integrator. Okay, so this one is the Monte Carlo integrator. Okay, accuracy 0.007. Now let's run this quasi Monte Carlo integrator. -5 × 10⁻⁵. Okay, so actually this one works too. We do not need the randomness. Equidistributed numbers do the same thing and they do it even better. The reason why they do it even better is because we do not have this problem of sometimes having points clustering, sometimes having points leaving out regions. So now we are in the following situation. The randomness is an important feature because it breaks up the curves of dimension. But the randomness also leads to the fact that there are regions which are sometimes missed and some regions which sometimes are coming too often. So this motivates our next session. The discrepancy is a measure to measure if a sequence is filling the space evenly. And with this definition, we can actually derive something which corresponds to the Chebyshev inequality and then to the Monte Carlo convergence rate. And this motivates then the so-called low discrepancy sequences. So that was it for today. I will be here for more questions if you like. And we will do the low discrepancy sequences in the next session. Thank you.